Good evening. My name is Kadaria Ahmed, and this is Straight Talk. My guest is a journalist who specializes in investigative reporting and has won numerous accolades for his work. In 2010, he was the Wolesoyinka Investigative Reporter of the Year. In 2011, he won the same award again and was also named the Forum for African Investigative Reporters Investigative Journalist of the Year, an advocate for accountability, transparency, respect for the rule of law, and the defense of human rights. My guest is currently the West Africa representative of the US-based Committee to Protect Journalists, a non-profit organization promoting freedom worldwide by defending the rights of journalists to report the news without fear of reprisal. On Straight Talk today, I'm very pleased to have with me Mr. Peter Nkanga. Mr. Nkanga, welcome to Straight Talk.
Thank you for having me.
You wrote a letter to President Muhammadu Buhari not too long ago. What did you say in your letter?
Wow. Several things were said. Several things that concern Nigeria as an entity and every Nigerian in this country. We simply asked President Muhammadu Buhari to be a friend of the press. And it did twofold. The first fold is his antecedent from where he was and where he's coming from as a military ruler wasn't press friendly. In fact, you could term him a press predator. So now he's coming a second time with so much hope in the air, with citizens aspiring for a change. We're asking him to be a friend of the press, and there are several ways.
So let me just ask here. This is what, a timely reminder that he's no longer in the military and that he's a democratically elected president and therefore needs to do things differently?
Very correct. Spot on. Yes, that's what we're asking him to do.
Okay.
And we just helped to highlight some of the challenges he's inheriting from past and previous administrations, right from military rule up to civil rule 1999 till present. And we highlighted some of the research and findings and investigations CPJ has done over these years. And amongst these, we have been able to see that Nigeria has a sad history of impunity when it comes to journalists who are murdered in the line of duty. I mean, if we go back right from 1986 to the point of Dede Giwa, but CPJ has an index, a global impunity index, and it brings out and it calculates 10-year span of how many journalists have been murdered in the line of their work and what form of justice has prevailed.
Where does Nigeria sit on this index?
As of 2014, Nigeria was the 12th worst country.
In the whole world?
In the whole world.
In terms of the way journalists are treated?
Yes.
What is the sort of criteria that is looked at? So is what people who die in the line of duty, people who are locked up, people who are... What are the things that you look at in putting together this index?
It calculates a span of 10 years, every 10 years. So we look at within that 10-year time, how many journalists have been killed in the country, and CPJ can directly and conclusively say is it because of that journalism? That's one. Then we also do a map of all of this. And the most important criterion is to note that it is also based on the population of the country. And out of these 10 years that we were able to calculate, the five journalists we were able to put within this bracket were an NCA of Channels, Zacharias of MTA, and the light bearers in Jos and Bayo, who was in 2009. Within this period, all the journalists were killed because of their work as journalists, and nothing in form of justice has been brought.
To date, as far as we know, nobody has been prosecuted for those killings.
For those murders.
Okay, so you wanted to draw his attention to this particular thing, and what else?
And also, across Africa now, it's given that journalism has a major role to play in the development of a country, in the democracy of any country. And that is why all around the world, just even May 27, the United Nations Security Council made a draft resolution that journalists should be protected. That's why we have the World Press Freedom Day, to draw home the attention that, look, press freedom is an issue that concerns journalists. May 3rd. November 3rd, we have also the World Day Against Impunity, which says media practitioners should not be targeted for their work. So all of this shows us that press freedom at its very moment now around the world is a very deadly or critical issue, and journalists are easy targets for attacks on them by state and non-state actors.
And therefore, your letter wants the president to do what?
We're asking him, among several things, reopen some of these cases that have to do with the murder of journalists. Reopen them. Like the police always say, no case is dead if it's a criminal case. Reopen them. Let there be justice. This just happened in Burkina Faso just some days back. The African court asked for the case of journalists to be reopened in Burkina Faso. That's one thing we're asking him. The second we're asking that...
Is this Zongo?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
So the second one is we're asking
16 years ago.
That's right.
He was killed, if I remember correctly.
Yes, very correct. Right. The African court has ruled that the investigation should be reopened. And we're also asking President Buhari to also look at the laws that are being used to target the press. Criminal defamation is still existent. Sedition, it's still in the books, not been repealed, not been removed. We have publishing false information. CBJ believes that even there are fractions of the press, the way to go about it is not to imprison a journalist.
But aren't you in many ways misdirecting this letter? Because, you know, even though he is the president, you do realize, so we have a National Assembly that is charged with making rules and regulations for this country. Aren't you supposed to be talking to them if you're talking law?
Yes, I'm talking to everyone. We are talking to not only the executive, but not only also the judiciary and the legislative, all arms, even the public. But why we are specifically starting with the president is because he is the chief number one law enforcement officer in this country. And most of the attacks that happen against the press are committed by state actors, by the police, the military, the SSS, and they are the ones that get away with the impunity the most. And it is on his own doorstep that that lies. Too many cases, just within this 1 week of his inauguration, we've had at least 4 journalists who have been attacked.
For doing their job.
For doing their job. The most unfortunate one is one that happened on the day of inauguration, May 29th, when a journalist from Daily Trust, Joseph Hare, who has been attacked in the past, CPJ has documented some attacks on him in the past, he was bundled, suffocated, and accidentally fainted right there at the inauguration ground of the governor.
And we're talking here about, because I want specifics, we're talking about Nasarawa State.
Nasarawa State.
Has he said anything, the governor, about this particular case?
Yes. I personally called the governor. I spoke with him. And he said I should send him an SMS. I sent him the SMS. Till date, I have not received a response. But that is not the first time when you, in the course of my work, when I have to interact with people who have the authority to change some of these attacks or some of these nefarious activities on the press, they are not forthcoming a lot of times. And that's why we're engaging not only him now as the president, but even the security forces. You can't continue attacking the press for doing their job. They have a constitutional duty, responsibility. All of us that listen to the news, whether on radio, on TV, we want the information they're given. That's why we tune into those stations. But if you attack the people who bring that information to you, as well denying the people of the information that they seek.
Why is a free press important in your mind?
Until somebody has felt what it is to be deprived of his rights, especially liberty, he believes he owns it. Until you are deprived of that right, you might not understand what that right means to you. And press freedom is that right for people, for the public to be informed about their commonwealth, to be informed about how their resources are spent, to be informed about why your roads are not working, to be informed about why is it alleged that somebody took such amount of money as meant to be used for power, to be informed about why the oil that is our commonwealth is not evenly distributed. It is the journalists that ask those questions that you and I, the public, want to hear. And that is press freedom. When you deny them that right, when you censor the activities, when you kill them for reporting and getting investigative truth about an issue, when you stop them from having access to information that they need the people to get, that is press freedom that has been attacked. That is the right of every citizen that has been attacked.
If we look around Nigeria today, by and large, we have a multitude of media, from print to television to radio, and largely, you know, operating freely. So are you exaggerating these problems?
I am not, and I will just use examples. Two Nigerian journalists went to the north to go and get information that people wanted during the election. And the military decides to keep them in their hotels and deny their movement for over a week.
Here you're talking about the Al Jazeera journalists during the last elections, okay.
And that is an instance that could have been, I like always putting it very simple. The banker has his own job to do, which is to provide financial services to the public. The teacher has his own job to do, to inform and to teach. So also the lawyers, the doctors, and the journalist has his own job to do. And if there have been so many attacks on the press, as far back that 1986, a murder of a journalist took place until date, there is no form of respite for that family. I had an opportunity of meeting some of the families of slain journalists. And when you find out the tears up till today, they're still crying because there have been so much, sometimes a lot of overwhelming evidence to show where you should investigate and find the culprit, but nothing is done.
Do you get a lot of local support for your work from local journalists, from local media houses?
Oh, yes. That's the main thing. Since I'm doing a local work, I need the local support. I can't be doing it in isolation. And that's why I always reach out to people, to anyone, from every field of endeavor to see the reason why they should be a supporter of press freedom is for their own good, for the public's good. And I do get a lot of support from journalists themselves, individuals, and also for some of the media houses, and even unions, press unions across the whole region, and international organizations who also believe in this, and individuals. People sometimes say, I read that your report. How is that journalist? Thank you for doing that for him. I get emails saying, thank you for the work you're doing. Those are the encouragements that make me believe that this is not a lost cause.
If someone is watching this today, and they're Nigerian, and they're sort of so impressed with you, and they decide we want to support the work the CPJ is doing financially, what are the avenues open to them?
Well, the first point of any communication, if they don't have mine, is to go to the website, which is cpj.org, that's https://cpj.org. And from there, there are different places where you say, reach out to us, contact us, and you can do that. That is the surest way that you will definitely get
the
response and information. And surprisingly, a lot of the information that will be asked as well is already on the website. We'll make it a very interactive communication platform. And emails are responded to on time, communications are responded to on time.
Let us take a break. When we return, we speak about credibility and responsibility in the media. Don't go away.